When a political party has been in power for a decade or longer in this country, outside of Alberta, because Alberta's a different animal, but outside of Alberta, folks in Canada have change on their minds once a party gets long in the tooth and has been in power for 10 years or longer. Doesn't matter whether it's federal politics, provincial. Hey, voters get restless. The NDP has been in power here in Manitoba since 1999. So here we are in year number 14. It should surprise nobody that on this very, very frosty May Day, a day before a rally on the steps of the Manitoba legislature to protest the new Democratic Party's latest assault on democracy, people are in a foul mood, just like they are in BC and Ontario, and you know what? Probably in Alberta right now. In the mood to throw the bums out. So it's time for some Canadian common sense. People here in my adopted hometown of Winnipeg love their hockey team, their Jets. Oh, yeah, I know, the Jets missed the playoffs by just a nose. But people still love them. Well, in the final week of the Jets season at the downtown hockey arena, the MTS Center, it was packed as it always is for the Jets games. One of those in the seats was the premier of this province, NDP leader Greg Selinger, the successor in name only to Gary Doer. He was the one, Gary Doer was the one who took the NDP back to power in 1999 after a decade of Tory rule. Today, Doer is Canada's ambassador to the States. He was cheered everywhere he went in this province and cheered loudly if his face popped up on a scoreboard for a football game or hockey game. Last year, Doer was caught in the stands by a Jets camera, and when his face flashed on the giant scoreboard, a powerful cheer rumbled through the arena. But it's not the same with Greg Selinger. Last week, his successor in name only had his face similarly pop up, and the cheers were nowhere to be heard. Because if there were any at all, they were drowned out by loud and lusty jeers. Were they jeering Greg Selinger's personality? I don't think so. The man has no personality. It was about his politics. People in Manitoba, whether they vote Conservative or Liberal or NDP, they've got a passion for democracy. And at the moment in the Manitoba legislature, the premier is taking the democratic will for granted, treating the voters as chumps and taking them for a ride. He has a majority, and so he feels that he has numbers to pass a piece of legislation which would rifle through the pockets of every single Manitoban who purchases a good or a service. And by now you know, this is about the least progressive form of taxation. This is the tax, this sales tax, that, well, it just doesn't care whether you're rich or poor in the middle. You all pay the same freight. It's the sales tax, the provincial sales tax, currently in Manitoba at 7%. And so if the NDP chooses not to prune the public sector, one of the most bloated in the country, and it hasn't, their only choice, they feel, is to keep increasing taxes. And so they've made beer and cigarettes very expensive. Gasoline is more expensive. So are fishing licenses and driver's licenses and traffic tickets and everything that can carry an extra fee or a tax is bearing the burden. But the increase in the PST, that's a different animal. Provincial sales tax is being increased by 1 point, which means a 14% increase in that tax take for the government. Hundreds of millions of new dollars for the government. One extra point added to the number 7, that's right, is a 14% increase, which is why hundreds of millions of new dollars are flowing from Manitoba pockets to the public sector. It's more vicious to the folks than just a 14% increase in the PST loot for the government. It's an affront to the democratic process, an assault on democracy, because a previous government had passed a very good bill, supported by the overwhelming majority of Manitobans. That bill stated that if any government happens to increase the PST, wants to do that, it can only do it if the public gives it permission. The public has to vote for that increase in a referendum. Will there be a referendum here in Manitoba? No. The government does not believe it could win such a referendum. And on that, the government and I are on the same page. They couldn't win. The people would defeat such a referendum overwhelmingly. I don't think you'd get more than 1 out of every 4 Manitobans voting for an increase in their PST, no matter what sob story the premier wants to tell them in a campaign. These days, he sobs about floods and says the extra money is needed to fight floods. Problem is, everyone in Manitoba knows we've always had rivers. We've always had floods. Some people think humans weren't supposed to be living on these lake and river beds, which produce the wonderful land that we call Manitoba. So we're in that flood zone, always have been. Floods and rivers, always been there, always will be. The budget problem is about, no, it's not about the Red River. The budget problem is not about the Red or the Assiniboine or the Seine River. It's about insane spending by government on fat cat bureaucrats who crowd out all the money needed for ordinary people to grow their economy. So frontline workers, whether they're in the public sector, like teachers and nurses and police officers and firefighters, they have so many people in healthcare, so many people in education, so many people in public safety doing desk duty, that the government is drowning. It's rivers of spending that are flooding the province with debt. And that's why right now the Selinger government is just pigpiling the people, piling on another point to the PST. And the only way they can do it, since they can't win a referendum on it, is to pass a piece of legislation that gives them the green light to do it. And so one of the most unpopular pieces of legislation in history is now being passed, rammed through, to shred a popular piece of legislation that gave the people direct democracy on something they cared about deeply. It gave them an insurance policy against an increase in the PST. Now, the Premier can do all this legally, but ethically, it's a zero. Morally, it's bankrupt. I mean, it's something that gets you booed at a hockey game by thousands of people, many of whom voted for his party 2 years ago, but swear they'll never do that again. Now, of course, he's hoping that's just temporary. He's hoping they're just kidding. But, Premier, I've got news for you. The message is as plain as the nose on the face. This law of yours is not a barn burner in popularity. It smells worse than a hog barn in July. And 2 years from now, analysts will be saying that 16 years after Gary Doer brought the NDP back from virtual extinction, the people of Manitoba had a pig roast. They roasted a 16-year-old pig on the spit of democracy. Tomorrow night, there's a rally in Winnipeg, Manitoba. I don't know how many folks will turn out in the cold, but I do know that 2 years from now, the Selinger government will be turned out in the cold because the people won't be suffering amnesia. They won't forget the day democracy was captured and butchered in the Manitoba legislature. That's Canadian common sense. Folks, if you're in Manitoba, make sure to attend the big rally. If you're pro-democracy, which I think you are, the rally against the government's referendum-free PST hike. It's tomorrow night, 6 p.m. Manitoba time, 6 p.m. Central, at the Legislative Building. And if you're not in Manitoba, but you know someone who is, make sure they know it's happening. For more, we're joined by one of the rally's organizers, Janine Carmichael of the CFIB, the Canadian Federation of Independent Business. Let's just go through the major sponsors. Your organization and the CTF, we're big fans of the CTF as well, as you know, right. Canadian Taxpayers Federation, and I think the Restaurant Association is involved as well.
Exactly. Those are the three big groups sponsoring the event.
All right. So with three big groups sponsoring the events, lots of names in their database, should be a big event, right, despite the cold?
Yeah, exactly. We are hoping for a great turnout. We are working the phones. We are emailing members. We are active on social media. And we're trying to bring in some big names, too, certainly for our organization. Dan Kelly, our president and CEO, is coming in for this rally. This is an important, important event for Manitobans to speak out and to be heard.
Now, of course, the government is counting on the idea of the passive Manitoban who kind of just watches these things happen. The wisdom there is that the Manitobans won't march. That maybe they marched in 1919 during the general strike, but they haven't marched much since then. But in fact, there is, I think, a lot of enthusiasm for the restoration of democracy here. This isn't just an economic issue. I think it's fair to say that the overwhelming majority of people supported the bill passed a number of years ago, which was supposed to prevent this kind of thing. It specifically says, and they've got to shred that bill in order to get this tax across, it specifically said that a government should not have the authority to do this unless the people agree to doing it in a referendum.
Yeah. I think that's what's so interesting about this issue is I think for those of us who follow public policy closely, we've seen a lot of moves in Manitoba that have been moving us away from competitiveness, away from, as you talk about, the democracy piece. And I feel like with this move, increasing the PST without a referendum, the government has crossed the line. And Manitobans are engaged. And they want to be a part of it, and they want to speak out. And so we want to make this opportunity for them.
And I think the government is making a huge mistake in thinking that this is some kind of right-of-center partisan thing. I mean, many, many people who vote NDP take it seriously, the letters, New Democratic Party. And so they don't think that this is something that a Tommy Douglas, and I could run down the list of the icons, would support the idea of taking a Democratic bill and literally putting it in the shredder. Now, of course, the government says that the reason they're doing this is because we've got rivers and floods.
Yeah. You know what? This is not the reason we're doing it. Manitoba has a spending problem, not a revenue problem. And we've had that for years. And now we're seeing the cumulative impact of that. And if the government was serious about infrastructure and funding its priorities for flood mitigation, it can do that. And it can do that by controlling spending and funding its priorities, not asking Manitobans who are already taxed to the max to even pay even more.
You know, it's interesting. I was just looking at some numbers, and I don't want to turn this into policy wonk central here, but if we had the average number of public servants in Manitoba that they have, you know, across the country, just the Canadian average, we would have 24,000 fewer people in the public service. Yeah. If we had 24,000 fewer people in the public service, we wouldn't have a deficit. We wouldn't have this outrageous debt. We wouldn't have the so-called emergency.
Exactly. You're exactly right. That's the number one thing that Manitoba can do, is get the size and the cost of the civil service in order. And just to put this in context, in the last throne speech, the government said that they would reduce the size of the government by 600 in 3 years. So you might think, well, that's a step in the right direction, and it is. But consider this. In Saskatchewan, they did 600 in 1 year. And this is through attrition. This is not through people losing their jobs. This can be done. We have to live within our means. Families and entrepreneurs, they do it every day. And they expect their government to do the same.
And I guess, just as, speaking as a Manitoban, what bothers me most is this nonsense that they keep saying, that all of this is about making sure that we've got doctors and nurses and teachers, when in fact you've got thousands of people involved in the healthcare system, the education system, who aren't doing doctoring and nursing. They're, you know, pushing paper around there in administration. God love them. I hope they find work somewhere. But the idea that the doctors and the nurses can't live without all of them is just a lie.
It truly is. The bottom line, Charles, this is about spending. This is not about revenue. We've got to get serious about that, focusing on our priorities of Manitobans.
Janine, good luck tomorrow night. Thanks
Thank
for
you.
Doing this.
Thanks.
Janine Carmichael of the CFIB here in Manitoba, the Canadian Federation of Independent Business.